Welcome to the second episode of Naval Battles That Never Happened. Today we're going to be looking at HMS Thunderchild, the fictional warship mentioned in H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds, and how effective it might have been in real combat against an adversary other than the Martians. For a quick overview, in Wells's book, Martians invade England around the year 1898. They drop from the sky in cylinders that deploy three-legged war machines that are pretty much unstoppable. At one point during the invasion, civilians are fleeing on a river steamer when three Martian tripods appear. HMS Thunderchild, a vaguely described Royal Navy warship, charges the Martians in a valiant attempt to slow their advance. Despite being outmatched, Thunderchild destroys a tripod with her cannons before succumbing to the Martian heat rays. The flaming wreck of the ship still manages to ram another tripod, destroying it. When the smoke is clear, the third tripod is also gone, allowing the steamer to get to safety. Wells doesn't provide many specific details as to what kind of ship Thunderchild is, and those details he does provide are confusing, as he refers to it as a torpedo ram and an ironclad on separate occasions. This is kind of understandable because of the rapid pace of warship development in the 1890s, so it's not really a fault on his part. Another YouTuber, Drachinifel, made an excellent video where he hypothesizes exactly what Thunderchild would have been based on the description and what it appears capable of in the book. If you want more details, go check out that video. It's fascinating and very well done. What he came up with was an armored torpedo ram, shown here, artwork and design done by Baron Engels. I reached out to Drachinifel through Patreon, asking if I could use his design for this video, and he approved. I thought it would be interesting to see how the design would hold up against a contemporary threat, the German battleship SMS Kaiser Friedrich III, which is the battle we'll be dealing with today. The situation is that it's New Year's Day, 1900. After a drunken New Year's Eve exchange with a local patron at the Jolly Sailor, a pub in Heybridge Basin, an enraged Prince Henry of Prussia decides to take the newly completed battleship Kaiser Friedrich III and sail it up River Blackwater in order to destroy the offending pub. At 11:15 that morning, HMS Thunderchild, an armored torpedo ram, is the only Royal Navy vessel present at the mouth of the River Blackwater. Upon spotting the approach of the German battleship, Petty Officer Joseph Bloggs, the local patron from the Jolly Sailor the night before, informs Captain Herbert George Wells of the New Year's Eve altercation he had. Bloggs tells him that the drunken German he encountered claimed to have a battleship at his disposal and would reduce this damnable establishment to tinders, after Bloggs had told him that his hat looked stupid. In response, Bloggs dared him to do so, to which the prince replied, "Tomorrow morning, when you see my ship bearing down on this place, know that it is I, Prince Henry of Prussia, and I will stop at nothing to see it destroyed," which sounded even more threatening with a German accent. Bloggs didn't really think the guy was Prince Henry, but here they were. Captain Wells, realizing the seriousness of the situation, with his crewmen having insulted Prince Henry's famous headwear, and knowing his ship is the only thing that stands in their way, gives the order to intercept the German battleship at full speed. I'm going to go over a few basics about the ships. As you can see from this diagram, HMS Thunderchild is a rather short vessel. It is similar in look to the older Victoria-class battleships. It has a twin 12-inch gun turret on the front, and in the rear a 9.2-inch gun with, I believe, a gun shield, no turret. Along the sides are 12 6-inch guns and 12 6-pounder guns in armored casemates, which is about what you'd expect. In addition, she carries four torpedo tubes in the bow. The idea behind Thunderchild is that she closes in on a target at a rather impressive speed of 21 knots, firing her 12-inch guns, then launches torpedoes when in range, and then, ideally, rams into the target. With an 11-inch armored belt and 12 inches of armor on the turrets, Thunderchild is very heavily armored, even compared to battleships of the time. Maybe this will allow for her to get close enough to fire the torpedoes. We'll see. On the German side, we have SMS Kaiser Friedrich III, lead ship of her class of battleships. Her layout is more traditional than Thunderchild's, as she carries two twin 9.4-inch gun turrets, one fore and one aft. While these guns are relatively low caliber for battleships of the time, they're just as effective as the Thunderchild's older 12-inch guns. Kaiser Friedrich also carries 18 5.9-inch guns, 12 in casemates along the side, and 6 in single turrets. There are also 12 88mm guns and 12 37mm guns spread out along the hull for close-in defense. She carries 6 torpedo tubes, and rather than the usual 4, with one pointing in just about every direction. Her armor is slightly thinner than Thunderchild's and spread over a larger area, giving her less protection overall. At full speed, she can make about 17.5 knots. At this time, Kaiser Friedrich III was so new that I don't believe she would have completed her sea trials by this point. Clearly, Prince Henry must have a lot of confidence to take her untested on a mission of this vital importance. At 11:15, it's sea state 2, clear and relatively calm. Both ships are 10,000 yards apart. Thunderchild is at the mouth of the River Blackwater, heading east at 12 knots, and Kaiser Friedrich is about 2,500 yards off the coast to the north and is moving west at 10 knots. Captain Wells understands the gravity of the situation as he sees the German battleship on the horizon and spends the next 6 minutes coming up with an ideally worded message to send. He's satisfied with himself for ultimately deciding to go with "State your intention," which is the message relayed to the signal lamp operator. However, operating the signal lamp that day was none other than Petty Officer Joseph Bloggs. After reading Wells' message, Bloggs decides to take some artistic license with the captain's words. At a distance of about 6,000 yards, at 11:21, Thunderchild signals two words to the German battleship: "Stupid hat." Irritated to the boiling point, Prince Henry orders his ship's main guns to open fire. The twin 9-inch guns suddenly roar to life, hurling their shells towards the incoming British ship. The shots land near enough to Thunderchild for the crew to feel the concussion, with Captain Wells being the only one on the bridge not flinching in the face of incoming fire. Seeing no other option, Captain Wells orders his engines to speed up and informs his helmsman to begin an attack run on the German warship. Thunderchild's main guns fire as she gradually accelerates to 18 knots. However, the speed inhibits her gunners from accurately aiming, and the shots fall short of the turret. Both ships continue to exchange gunfire from their forward turrets as they steam closer, taking a full minute to reload between shots. However, none find their mark. At 11:24, at a range of 2,900 yards, Kaiser Friedrich's main guns finally score a hit. One 9-inch shell pierces through Thunderchild's armor near where the deck meets the superstructure behind the forward turret. The shell detonates inside, doing tremendous damage to part of the crew compartment and leaving a gaping hole in the ship's belt. But it does little to stop her from continuing onward. Without missing a beat, Thunderchild's main guns reply, but again, miss. Realizing the increasing danger as Thunderchild steams closer, Prince Henry orders his ship hard to starboard, wanting to bring her rear turret into arc. As the battleship turns, its 6-inch and 88mm guns along the port side open fire. These guns have much faster rate of fire, shooting one shot every 12 seconds for the 6-inch guns and one shot every 4 seconds for the 88mm. Their shells aren't able to penetrate the thick armor on Thunderchild, but the explosions still do damage to the hull, in addition to destroying anything unarmored, such as funnels, railings, walkways, searchlights, masts, the crew, etc. On the bridge of Thunderchild, Captain Wells waits for the ideal range to launch torpedoes, as the scenery around him is chewed up by fire from the German ship. As soon as they're within 800 yards, Wells orders the torpedo tubes fired. Underwater, doors on the bow of the ship open and slide out of the way, revealing four forward torpedo tubes. All four torpedoes slip into the water and swim for their target at 30 knots. At 11:27, Thunderchild's main guns fire once more, missing again. Just moments before, one torpedo explodes against Kaiser Friedrich's submerged hull, sending a column of spray at least 30 feet into the air. With only 450 yards left between them, Captain Wells gives the order to go to flank speed and ram the German battleship. The helmsman adjusts course several degrees to port in order to compensate for Kaiser Friedrich's course change. On the bridge of the German ship, Prince Henry is about to order his men to brace for impact when the ship unexpectedly runs aground, knocking many of the officers and crew off their feet. At 11:30, Thunderchild gets up to 21 knots before her bow crashes into the side of the now immobilized German warship. The armored ram pierces through the hull below the waterline. For a moment, both ships just sit there, stuck together, completely dead in the water, until the gun crews on the Kaiser Friedrich resume firing the ship's arsenal of smaller guns. At point-blank range, the 6-inch, 88mm, and 37mm guns unleash a hailstorm of fire across the front of Thunderchild, striking her conning tower numerous times. Thunderchild's own main guns fire while her bow is lodged in the German battleship. However, both semi-armor-piercing shells blow clear through the upper works of Kaiser Friedrich without detonating. The shockwave caused by the gun firing still does damage to its own deck and that of the German ship. Captain Wells orders Thunderchild's engines in full reverse during the brief pause in German fire. As the Thunderchild backs away from Kaiser Friedrich, the seriousness of the battleship's underwater damage becomes clear. Water rushes in as Thunderchild's ram is extricated from the hull breach. The flooding from the combined ram and torpedo hit is catastrophic, causing the gutted German ship to immediately take on a list. Thunderchild does not come out of it unscathed, though. Her bow is wrecked and her torpedo launchers are disabled, with minor flooding in the compartment. On the bridge of Kaiser Friedrich, Prince Henry realizes his anger and cockiness has gotten the better of him. He orders his men to stand down and abandon ship at 11:33. The ship lists another few degrees before settling on the shallow bottom. No longer under fire, the Thunderchild moves in to rescue the crew of the German battleship. Prince Henry, however, manages to slip away on a one-man launch that he navigates across the channel. Henry was willing to admit his errors, but when the Thunderchild rammed his ship, he lost his favorite hat. And he wasn't about to be seen without his hat, due to an old maritime tradition.
Oh. Holy cow! My cap blew off! How could I be an admiral without my cap?
Petty Officer Joseph Bloggs disappears from the pages of history shortly after the engagement, never to be seen again. Chances are he's probably living somewhere under a fake name. The Jolly Sailor still stands in Heybridge Basin to this day, now in color. Why Prince Henry of Prussia was drinking there on New Year's Eve squabbling with locals is a mystery that has never been solved, and it never will be solved since it didn't happen. So now let's discuss what happened here and why. I ran this scenario 4 times since it really consisted of a single attack run. The major disadvantage that Kaiser Friedrich had was its situation. Thunderchild was already set up for an attack run before the engagement even began. She only opens fire after communicating at 6,000 yards, which I thought seemed close, but actually by late 1890s standards, this was typical firing range. The German ship, its accuracy at that point was still like 5%. As a result of Thunderchild's relatively high speed, the short engagement range, and the poor accuracy of guns at the time, Kaiser Friedrich had little opportunity to deal damage to her opponent. The only thing that could have stopped Thunderchild was a lucky hit on a magazine or the conning tower, but during all 4 attempts at this scenario, it never happened. At worst, Thunderchild took a hit from the main guns that did substantial damage, but no critical hit. Regarding the torpedoes, there's a few problems. First, Dawn of the Battleship won't let you fire underwater torpedoes at speeds above 18 knots, which was kind of a limiting factor. At that speed, the torpedoes had very little chance of hitting anyway. They're all very old, with a range of about 800 yards and no gyroscopes. They were replaced like a year or two after this with high-pressure torpedoes that could go twice as far. Hitting the Kaiser Friedrich with more than one torpedo was very, very unlikely. However, as expected, a single torpedo did catastrophic damage to ships from this era. As far as the ramming attack goes, it worked how you'd expect on paper. During this era, naval planners still believe that naval ramming attacks were an effective strategy. If you recall the Battle of the Monitor and the Merrimack during the American Civil War, we see this type of stalemate occur where both ships aren't able to hurt each other with their guns, so ramming was thought to be the alternative. Another battle where this happened was the Austro-Hungarians fighting the Italians at the Battle of Lissa, where the Austro-Hungarians rammed an Italian battleship to win the battle. There were also several incidents where friendly ships collided, and the damage was exacerbated by the presence of the ram. And all of this made planners think ramming was still viable. However, even by 1900, the guns had done a lot of catching up to the armor. And within 5 years of this battle, the effective gunnery range and accuracy of shipboard guns would increase dramatically, making the ram pretty much obsolete again. So while this scenario accurately represents what would have happened in 1900 under these conditions, a few years later, it would have been a very different story. Finally, there's the grounding of the Kaiser Friedrich. When coming up with the scenario, I hadn't considered that a battleship probably could get down the River Blackwater without running aground, and certainly not as far as Heybridge Basin. On one of the last attempts at the scenario, I realized the German ship was close enough to the coast where I was supposed to be rolling for grounding. I rolled, and it happened. I thought it was kind of funny, so I went with it. Maybe if the approach was timed right with the tides, the ship wouldn't have been grounded. I don't know. Prince Henry was an expert sailor and would certainly have known better. But hey, someone insulted his hat, so give the guy a break, right? So that's it for this second episode of Naval Battles That Never Happened. Hope you enjoyed it. Remember to hit the like button and subscribe to my channel for more content like this. More content is coming. And again, I'd like to thank Drachinifel for allowing me to test out his HMS Thunderchild design. If you like videos about warships, check out his channel. His episode on Thunderchild in particular is very insightful, so go check it out. Oh, and I'm going to leave you with a bit from Jeff Wayne's War of the Worlds. It's a rock opera album from 1978 that the U.S. really missed out on, for the most part. And it became an amazing live show in the 2000s. It's on YouTube for free. Go watch it. It's great. And I'll see you next time on Naval Battles That Never Happened.
Moving swiftly through the waters, cannons blazing as she came, wrote a mighty metal warlord. crashing down in sheets of flame, sensing victory was nearing, thinking fortune must have smiled.